I'm Malcolm Jolley for Good Food Revolution with Celia Méndez from Viñátigo. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
I was practicing.
Viñátigo. Yeah.
Which is a very interesting and cool winery in a very interesting and cool place. Tell me about where Viñátigo is.
Okay, Viñátigo is in the village of La Guancha, which is in the northwest of the island of Tenerife, the biggest island of the Canary Islands. The Canary Islands are an archipelago that are off the coast of Morocco. It takes like 3 hours to fly from Madrid towards the south. So La Guancha is the village where I was born, where my father and mother were born, where my grandfathers were born. Like, all my family was born in that village, and they have been growing and making wine there for centuries. Just maybe not as long as they have been growing grapes in the Canary Islands, but yeah, a very long tradition. So we are in the village of La Guancha, and we grow all our grapes in the northwest of Tenerife, from the village of San Juan de la Rambla to the village of Buenavista del Norte, and at many different altitudes. For example, in the village of San Juan de la Rambla, we would grow grapes by sea level, as well as in the village of Garachico, but we can go very, very high, up to 1,000 meters high, in the highest parts of the village of Icod de los Vinos. So yeah, in such a tiny territory that you can go with your car only like 30 minutes, we grow 12 different grapes varieties.
And we were talking about that before. I mean, this means there's all kinds of microclimates and
exactly
conditions.
Because the island of Tenerife has the Teide volcano, which is almost 4,000 meters high. It's the highest peak in Spain. So when the trade winds arrive from the north of the Atlantic, they are blocked by this huge wall. And at 1,200 meters, the clouds kind of get condensed, and it creates a myriad of microclimates. By sea level, you can be at 21 degrees or 23 degrees all year round. And the higher you go, the colder it will get. For example, where we grow the grape Malvasia, it would be a super mild weather by sea level. But if you go where we grow the grape Titilla, which is at 600, 900 meters high, you will have a more extreme kind of continental climate, meaning that during the day it can be 20 degrees, but during the night it can be 5. So a very wide scenario of microclimates.
When we were tasting the wines before, you said that you thought the Canary Islands were the beginning of the new world and the end of the old world for wine. Tell me more about this.
Yeah.
And tell me about the grapes that are grown.
The Canary Islands were discovered by the Spanish and French conquerors back in the 14th, 15th century before America was discovered, due to its strategic position in the map. Because when the conquerors wanted to go to the Indias, meaning America, they had to go through the Canary Islands due to the trade winds, as I did before. So many of these conquerors established themselves in the Canary Islands, and for sure they were Catholic, and they needed the wine for their rituals and everything, so they brought with them all their grapes. So they brought grapes from all over Spain, from Portugal, and also from France and from Italy. And that's what I say that is like the first region of the new world, because it's the first place in the world where viticulture from many different places come together and merge together. If we talk about training methods, in my village, it's very popular to grow the grapes using the barral, the pergola training method, like in the north of Portugal, because it's so humid that it's very important to separate the grapes from the soil to avoid diseases and to have like a higher ventilation. And if you take your car and you go to Santiago del Teide, which is only 30 minutes away, you would be on the south face of the island, so the trade winds doesn't influence the weather there, and it's very hot. And this is where the people from Castilla settle themselves. So you will see that the training method used is the little bashes, because they needed to protect the grapes with the leaves. So yeah, it's all about fusion and
variety. I mean diversity.
Exactly, because all these people brought with them grapes that later disappeared in Europe due to phylloxera. But due to the volcanic soils of the islands, the phylloxera never affected the vines in none of the seven islands of the Canary archipelago. So we are very lucky to say that together with Santorini or Chile, we are one of the very few regions in the world which are 100% exempt of phylloxera.
Yeah, amazing, an amazing heritage. We have five wines with five different varietals of grapes. Could tell me a little bit about each one.
Yeah. For example, we can start with, for example, Viñátigo Blanco. This Viñátigo Blanco was founded by my father in the island of El Hierro, which is the smallest island. This Viñátigo Blanco, it's like an endemic grape of the Canary Islands, and we don't know what's the equivalent in Europe. Then he brought it to the island of Tenerife, and as it's a very well adaptive grape to the environment, we grow it from sea level up to 1,000 meters high. So it's very versatile. Then, for example, we have...
And produces, I just want to say, acidic, mineral, a little salty, bright, crisp, gastronomic white wine.
All of this. It's so acidic, such an acidic grape, that what we do is that we age it in barrels to kind of balance this high acidity, so you have this mixture of cream and saltiness on the palate, and all the tropical aromas that you have that will pop in your nose. Then we also have Malvasia Aromatica, which is the Malvasia from Greece, from Lipari. I have to say that in the Canary Islands we have two kinds of Malvasias. In the island of Lanzarote you have Malvasia Volcanica, that is a cruise between the Malvasia Aromatica from Greece and the Marmajuelo, which is another endemic variety of the Canary Islands. In this case, Malvasia Aromatica has been a very important grape in the Canary Islands because it was the grape from which the Canary wine was made from.
Right.
The Canary wine was that super famous sweet wine that was exported all over the world in the 15th and 16th century, that Shakespeare and Lord Byron talk about that, and Casanova on their literature. So what we do with this wine is an off-dry style wine that is super terpenic and aromatic on the mouth, and it's quite sweet and salty on the palate. So from my point of view, it's like an amazing aperitif wine. Then we have our approach to orange wine that we made from the grape Gual. Gual is a grape that was brought from Portugal because it has a synonym in the island of Madeira, Boal. The big difference is that in the island of Madeira it's always fortified, but in the Canary Islands we make it dry, and in this case we make, as I said before, an orange wine that is aged in concrete eggs, so it gets a more rounded and creaminess structure on the palate. Due to the fact that Gual also is a very like smoky grape, even if it's not aged in oak, so it's something very cool to taste and to play with different pairings, because it's very surprising. Regarding the reds, we have Cristal Negro, which is the most cultivated grape in the Canary Islands, and it's also an endemic grape. It's a cruise from Listan Blanco, that it's a synonym for Palomino Fino in Jerez, and Negramore, which is a grape that got to the Canary Islands through the island of Madeira. It's like the classic red, so we do a super simple vinification, only 3 months in barrel, and you get, it could be like our kind of Beaujolais wine, because it's the first one that goes to the market after the harvest, so it's like super easy drinking, and from my point of view, the best grape to communicate the volcanic essence of the Canary Islands.
There's a smoky note.
Yeah, super smoky, and also super peppery, and with many layers of complexity, but at the same time, super easy to drink. And the last red wine that we have is made from the grape Tintilla. And Tintilla literally in Spanish means something that has a lot of ink, So it has been very difficult for my father to study what tintilla really is, because everybody would say, oh yeah, that's tintilla. And he would find out that five different grapes had the same name. Anyway, if I am not wrong, it's an equivalent for Castellana Negra. I hope I'm not wrong, because there are so many grapes in my mind that I get lost. But tintilla is this super fun mixture of pepperness together with violets and more of a sea rice structure meets Cabernet Franc.
It was confusing in a very good way for me, because it is deep and dark.
Yeah.
But it's also light and bright.
So like
it's hard.
Yeah,
but
it
works.
Wine. So yeah, that's a little bit a few of the wines we have. We do have more single grape wines and blends and everything, but yeah, it's just some examples to see how fun the Canary Islands can get.
They're amazing wines. They're really interesting, and I know this is just a small cross-section of what you make and what comes from the islands, but thank you for sharing it.
Thank you. Thank you for being ready to taste.
Oh, I'm always ready to taste, especially good wine. Thank you.
My daddy was a rock and roller. My daddy was a rock and roller.